Hello, good morning, everyone. Sorry, there was a technical issue and we got delayed. I hope everyone's safe and doing well at home. As all of you are aware, now we are in this global pandemic of coronavirus, and there is uncertainty in everything. We really do not know when the schools are going to start, but this time can be used as to how to prepare yourself, how to prepare the school, how to prepare the staff, the children, as well as parents. So when actually the school will start, everyone would be prepared rather than being confused at that point or getting panicked. So today's discussion would be more on how to make a safe atmosphere at school, both for the children as well as for the teachers. So this is a difficult period for everyone, and especially for the children as well. So we all are there to guide and help the children to have a safe journey in this period. So if meanwhile, if you have any questions regarding how to take care of the child and how to safeguard the environment at school, please drop in questions. So that would be in more easy and interactive, because then I would be able to answer your queries as well. So when it comes to this coronavirus and the schooling, this period can be used to educate the children as well as parents regarding the coronavirus, how they need to safeguard themselves as well as the surroundings. So I'm sure most of the teachers are doing a wonderful job by having this online teaching and online classes for the child, where everyone's emphasizing on hand washing. So by educating the child regarding the proper method of hand washing, proper respiratory etiquettes will go a great way ahead, because the coronavirus spreads mainly through droplets. So if a good hand hygiene is maintained and a good respiratory etiquettes is maintained, the chances that the coronavirus would spread would be comparatively less. So educate the child from now on by hand washing techniques like rubbing the palms, rubbing the back, rubbing the fingertips, rubbing the wrist and the thumb. So ensure that the child is rubbing and cleaning all the surfaces of the hand. The second thing is, we are lucky enough to have many comics for the children, many educative sheets which are there, and activity sheets which are there for the children, to make it a fun-based activity and letting them know the importance of hand hygiene. Now, what is important during this period is you need to emphasize on the positive aspects and the preventive aspects about the coronavirus, because of social media, and there are many myths of coronavirus. So these things should be removed from a child's mind, and only correct and facts of the coronavirus should be transferred to them. The same thing with the parents. So I think the teachers should work hand in hand with the parents and help in emphasizing these hygienic aspects with the child. The second thing is, now when the school starts, what all measures have to be taken at school to prevent the spread of coronavirus. So now at school, you have the few points, such as at the entry, in the corridors, in the school class, and during lunch. So what are the measures which need to be taken at the entry port? So at the entry port, what can be done is a thermal screening, just to ensure that no person entering the school has temperature. You can even have a self-declaration form stating that any person entering the campus doesn't have fever, cough, or cold. Ensure that once they enter into the campus, they are following strict hand hygiene practices. And as soon as they enter, you can either have a sanitizer or you can have hand washing stations where they sanitize the hand or have a good hand wash and then enter the school. It's always better to have one-way circulation of movement of people. So you can divide the entry and exit pathways if you have an option. Otherwise, you can just or draw a line which will divide the entry and the exit ways. So by doing this, you're preventing mingling of the people as well as communication between the people who are going on both ways. Another thing what can be done is have minimal things on the way from the school gate to the class. where they prevent touching each other or touching surfaces. So you can have something like a cube box which can be drawn from the entry to the class, so that if students come in a group, they can stand in their designated boxes. So it's always again better to have staggered entry time. Like, you know, you can divide the time at 10-15 minutes intervals, so that too many people do not come at once at the school gate. So by dividing that, you're again avoiding overcrowding, and then you would prevent the spread of the virus. So have staggered entry time, or you can either have alternate days of school for certain kids to avoid too many people at a place at once, or you can have shift system like morning, afternoon and evening based on the convenience. So this is something which can be done at the entry and the corridor. Now, as soon as a child is entering the class, if you have an option, it's always better to keep the door open, so that repeated handling of the day, the door knob would be avoided, because again, that is a source of contamination. Try to have a fixed seated pattern in class and avoid changing places or exchanging students in between tables, because this would again prevent the spread of the virus. Have a well-ventilated open classroom. Try to avoid having a classroom which is very stuffy and close, because good air circulation again decreases the intensity in case if a virus is there. Try to avoid sharing of materials between students, be it erasers, papers, or any even resources for study. So let each child have their own things and completely avoid sharing information or worksheets between students. Try to have at least 2 meter gap between two students. So I know, I totally understand it's very difficult, especially for primary school children to follow these rules, but as far as possible and as long as possible it's followed, it's always better for the children as such. So fixed seating arrangement, seating distance of at least 2 meters, avoid sharing of things between children. Try to avoid unnecessary items in the classrooms, which again would be a source of contamination. So have very minimal things which are really required. Have educative posters about hand washing and coronavirus hung at everywhere, because it's going to be a kind of positive reinforcement for a child. And reduce movement of objects or bags from one room to the other. So try to reschedule your timetable, which would prevent too much movement of students from one class to the other or from one corridor to the other. So just try to reschedule in such a way that the children is seated in a particular place for a longer time, and try to avoid mingling of students. Now, outdoor activities, in case social distancing is possible in certain outdoor activities such as running and exercise, well, that can be done. But like I told you, the queue boxes have to be maintained and the social distancing has to be maintained even for the outdoor activities. So the prerequisite what a child has to carry to school would be, the child should be wearing a mask, and so as the teachers, try to avoid too many things a child would be getting from home to school, because again, that would be a source of contamination. So preferably if you have school stuff at school and home stuff at school, at home, that would be great. The same thing applies for the staff and teachers as well. Try to avoid getting too many things to school, like, you know, be it 2-3 bags, or try avoiding accessories, because again, that would be a source of contamination, like, you know, bangles, or, you know, 2-3 bags or bracelets or a watch. In case you're getting anything to the school, just ensure that you, once you return home, you leave them outside in the balcony or veranda where it's exposed to the sun for 3-4 hours, and then you immediately need to take a shower. No other specific precautionary measure about the clothing needs to be done, but everyone needs to be careful that try to avoid excessive touching of the ears, nose, and face, because the virus spreads by hands touching the contaminated surfaces, and again, a person touching the eyes, nose, and mouth. So please, if anyone has any questions regarding anything, do please put, so that I will be able to answer the questions.
The question mark. Question mark. They have to keep the question mark.
Raise the question.
Okay, I have to tell them. So there's a question mark place for a question over there. In case you click the question, you would be able to ask questions. Yeah. Okay, so that comes to the classroom preventive strategies and protection. The next thing would be during lunch. So again, you need to have staggered lunch breaks and again designated seats during lunch, and again maintaining social distance of 2 meters. Just ensure that every time these shifts are changing, you completely disinfect the tables, the handles, the seats and everything. So this would prevent the spread of infection from one child to the other. Before starting school, one thing you need to tell the parents is any child having fever, cough, cold should avoid coming to school. And any child with underlying problems, medical problems such as you know, diabetes or heart issues or immune problems, even they should be trying to avoid to come to school. I have a question from that is it advisable to wear masks for kids for longer periods time? Yeah, so see, it's always better a child wear mask when the child is at school, because that's how it's going to a child can catch infection. The longer a child wears, the better it is. Of course, if there's no person in between 2 meters, that's fine. He can just remove it for some time. But it's always better for a child to wear the mask as long as possible. It's definitely going to be a difficult task, but it's always better to wear a mask. The next question is, what are the precautions to take from the school side? Yeah, like I told you, you basically need to divide at entry point, the corridors, the classrooms, the lunch and the common areas, and again during the departure, like from the exit. So I told you regarding the entry time where a thermal screening has to be done, sanitization or hand washing as soon as a child or any person enters the school, a self-declaration form stating that, you know, no person is having fever, cough, cold. Try to avoid too many children at the entry gate at once. Try to have a separate way for entry as well as exit to avoid mixing of people. And in the classrooms, at least 2 meters separated a well-ventilated classroom. Try to avoid sharing things between the children, and minimal carrying of stuff from home to school as well as school to home, and constantly disinfecting the high-risk areas such as the door knobs, the railings where the children try to, you know, hold onto the railings, walk up the stairs, down the stairs. So these are the areas where every 2 to 4 hours it has to be constantly disinfected, and whenever there's a change from the groups, when you're having these staggered breaks, when another group is coming to the classroom, disinfect the whole room. So we have a next question. What are the precautions? Yeah, like I just mentioned, what are the precautions? What are the precautions should we take at the time of transport? If possible, it's always better if a child comes in individual transport. If for some reason they need to take a group transport, then again, segregating the time, so that will limit the number of students in a same mode of transport, that can be done. And again, seating arrangement, seating should be that they are sitting 2 feet, and disinfecting, again, disinfecting the seats, disinfecting the handles, disinfecting the doors of the bus. All these need to be done before the child gets into a bus and as soon as the child gets down the bus, so as to keep it clean and safe for the next batch of children who are going to take in the transport. The person who is attending in the bus along with the child should also wear a mask, and everyone should follow strict hand hygiene. Like as soon as they enter, they need to use a sanitizer, and as soon as they get down the bus, they need to use a sanitizer. So the next question is, apart from N95 mask, which other type of mask can be recommended? Are disposable masks suggestible? See, N95 mask is only specific for people who are handling COVID-19 positive cases. So for a normal environment, what can be used, just like in a school environment, you can use any cloth mask, which can be washed and placed in the sun for 3 hours after use, or any surgical mask is also okay. But a cloth mask should be fine, because as long as there are not too many secretions by a child, because you're going to obviously screen symptomatic children. Any person with cough, cold is definitely not going to come to school. So normal masks should be okay. N95 is only for those staff members who are with the suspected child. So now if suddenly a child at school develops fever and cough, you need to isolate the child. And a staff member has to be there with the child if a child is a younger person. So those people who are with a suspected coronavirus patient, they need to take more precautionary measures, such as a N95 mask or a triple layer surgical mask, a cap and a plastic gown. So these things have to be worn in case you're with a suspected coronavirus child or a staff. But otherwise, a normal mask is okay. There's the next question from Sridevi. Can 25 to 28 children be seated in a classroom? Well, it depends again on the size of the class. If you're able to maintain a distance of at least 2 meters between two children, then that should be fine. At least if you're able to maintain that social distancing and you have a huge classroom, 25 children can be seated in a classroom. Our next question is from Rajita. How many hours is it advisable for students to be in school, half day or full day? See, with the present scenario of coronavirus going on, we do not know how long this virus is going to last. But at least till we find a treatment for the virus or vaccine, we definitely need to be more careful when children are there at school. So how many hours for older children? I think it's okay. They will be able to sustain for longer hours following these social distancing policies and hand hygiene policies. But for younger kids, I think it's going to be difficult, because even 2 to 3 hours making them sit at a place or making them wear their mask or trying to avoid interaction with kids is going to be difficult. So again, based on the age of the child, the necessity of the hours of the school needs to be taken. Probably, a longer hour duration school can be okay for older children, but practical difficulties would be there if you have longer hours for primary section children. So the next question is from Sunita. Is the age group for 3 to 4 hours safe for 3 to 6 years? So her question is, the question was, for 3 to 6 years, is it safe for them to wear a mask for 3 to 4 hours? To be practical, I don't think any child would constantly wear a mask for 3 to 4 hours. So what can be done is you can have a mask-free period, mask-free time, where you can take off your mask for 10 minutes every half an hour or so, so that you can breathe in fresh air. Again, when that is happening, you again need to be very careful with the social distancing and teach them that they're not supposed to touch their nose, hands or eyes, because constantly wearing for 4 hours, even for us, it's very suffocating. And then that again leads to many other things. So it's always better after every half an hour, you can have them give them this break-free period from the mask for around 10 minutes. That should be okay. So there's another question. What precautions can be taken in the washrooms? Yes, this is a very good question, because the main place where children try to stick together or they're very close is the washrooms, because we do not have that spacious washroom. So again, staggering the break time for kids, probably allowing just 2 to 3 kids at one time going to the washroom, And if the washrooms are very close, try to make them use the alternate washroom and then immediately washing their hands before they come out. And keeping, again, because the door handles are again a source of infection, please have someone so that they'll keep disinfecting the door handles as soon as a child comes out or comes in. Because these are some things which will prevent the spread of the virus. So one thing is staggering the break time for the washroom, allowing just a couple of children into the washroom at once, asking them to wash their hands, and sanitizing and disinfecting the area before another group of children go and use the washroom. And teaching them the proper hand hygiene techniques when they're washing their hands. That is another thing. So there's another question from Shilpa. When the child enters the school, few kids have allergies of sanitizer, like the palms become rough and have itching problem too. Yes, definitely we do see this. Prior of using sanitizer, you can just give a questionnaire to all parents asking them regarding if they have any, the child has any allergies or if the child's skin is sensitive. So then instead of sanitizer, just make sure you're asking the child to wash their hands. So that's why if you have an alternative of sanitizer and a hand washing station at regular intervals at school, this problem can be solved. Because using a sanitizer and washing the hands are equally effective. So in case a child is allergic to a particular kind of sanitizer, they can do the hand washing strategies. The next thing is it important for a kindergarten, by Rams, is it important for a kindergarten child to attend to school? That's a very tricky question because, one thing is a child enjoys the most when a child is there at school with their age kids. So obviously school is a good way of learning for a child, good way of socializing and for development. So I think we need to see the pros and cons when the school is going to start at, how severity, the severity of coronavirus, are there any medications available, any vaccine available, and then take a call regarding kindergarten. And children, because it's very difficult to make them understand regarding social distancing and teaching them not to mingle in groups. Some kids can be great, but then few kids can be difficult to manage or probably have very small groups of children, probably three to four children, and allocate one specific teacher just to three and four children, and do not allow these two, three groups of such children to mingle. If it's really, if it becomes mandatory for a kindergarten child to attend the school, then you can have very small groups of three to four, have a separate staff attending that group and avoid mixing of two groups. So whatever, if they have a break time, if they have a lunch time, just ensure that these groups are maintained always. So even in case one of the child gets sick, you can isolate just the three to four children rather than having the risk of getting the whole class exposed and, isolating all the children. But looking at the scenario, I think it's okay if the kindergarten school children don't attend school till we find some solution to the virus. But if it becomes mandatory, yeah, these are the precautions you can always follow. So there's a question from Monica. How about the washroom breaks for children? What are the precautions to be taken? I just answered that you have specific time for washroom breaks. Let it be staggered. Sanitize the child before entering the washroom. Have social distancing. And once they are out again, hand hygiene needs to be maintained. There's a question from Vidya. That's again a good question. Like any uniform, like apron, well covered, can be suggested to children. Wearing a mask itself is going to be difficult for a child. Now, if you're going to have an apron, I really do not know how many kids are going to be okay with it. The basic thing why any staff, like, healthcare workers or anyone involved in exposed wear this is to prevent contamination on the clothing. What you can do for this is as soon as a child enters home, just give the child a quick shower and wash their clothes immediately. So by doing this, it should be okay. There's not any necessity like a child has to wear an apron, which is well covered at this point, unless there's any, there was any suspected child in the school with coronavirus, then you can start thinking about wearing aprons or other measures like a head cap or a shield. But till everyone is okay at school, there's no real requirement of wearing an apron. There's another question from Satish Kumar. Continuous wearing of masks slows down the brain development. How do we deal with it? Is it a myth or a fact? Continuous wearing of mask, it again depends on the type of mask, what you're using in the surrounding environment, the surrounding temperatures, and how long consistently are you wearing a mask. See, practically, even doctors who are dealing directly with COVID-19 patients, they work for 4 to 6 hours, and then they have a break of 1 hour. So practically speaking, more than 6 hours, even wearing the N95 mask is going to be very difficult. So that's why, like I told, keep having mask-free intervals. So in case you're having a mask-free break, you can take a child to the outdoor area, have social distancing, and let them remove the mask. So in this way, you're sure that the child is going to get fresh air, and it's not going to, you know, totally suffocate the child. And if you actually see, it's only the N95 mask or the triple layer surgical mask which are actually having such problems. A normal cloth mask or a very simple mask is less likely because the airflow in it is definitely there. But keep having breaks for the mask as well. So there's another question, Ruchi Sharma. Does one need to wash hair every day as they are exposed to when we go out? What you can do, since it's anyways summer now, you can just give a quick shower. Don't have to apply a shampoo or anything, but a quick shower head to toe is always better when a child is exposed out. So another thing is, Manjula, is it suggestible for tiny tots of age groups 3 to 6 years come to school till the pandemic subsides? Yeah, I think I addressed the question. It again depends on the situation when the government asks the schools to reopen and the situation of coronavirus then, and if we have any treatment or vaccine coming up. But in case it becomes mandatory, you need to take the precautions. Otherwise, you can wait for a couple of months till things get better. So there's another question from Sophia. What if a student or staff exhibits any fever, cold symptoms during class or after coming to school? Well, I think practically you're going to face such situations once the school starts, and you have to be well prepared with it. So you need to have a sick room which is well ventilated and having very minimal things in the room. So as soon as you see anyone suffering from that fever or cold symptoms, you need to isolate the child into that separate room, immediately inform the doctor at school and the parents. What needs to be done is, if a child is younger, probably, you know, kindergarten or first or second, and someone has to be there beside the child, then that time the person attending the child should protect themselves. So in that case, you need to wear a good mask such as N95. You need to wear an apron, and you need to cover your head. So this is for a person who's attending the child in the sick room at school, and if social distancing of at least 2 meters is not possible. So once you hand over the child to the parent, the person who's attending the child needs to completely wash their hands. There's no need of changing clothes, as you're already protected because you're wearing an apron and head cap. But what is important is sanitization. You need to sanitize the sick room immediately and try to go back and see where all that was sitting or handle things, and try to sanitize all those areas where the child could have possibly touched and contaminated. Otherwise, you can wait for the results. No need of isolating any person specifically, but once, if by chance a result comes that it's positive, then any person who has had very close contact with that child needs to be isolated for 14 days. So there's another question from Shailaja. Please suggest few exercises or any meditation methods to improve immunity. Yeah. question, because these are some things which would help boost up the immunity. So what you can do is yoga, breathing exercises such as pranayamam, and educating the child that, you know, even at home, once they go back to school, try to have some exercises indoor or on the terrace on balcony. In case it's possible at school, you can have some outdoor exercises for the child, because vitamin D, the natural sunlight, is good for the child, as well as, you know, it's going to get them exposed to fresh. They'll be free from that mask for some time. So you can have exercises, you know, the physical exercises, any kind of physical exercise is okay. Yoga is good, and specifically breathing exercises and pranayamam are good for improving the lung capacity. So we have another question from Soma Goswami. Screen time is suggested for young kids. Is it advised, especially to avoid stress on eyes? On full-fledged, how much screen time is suggested for young kids, especially to avoid stress on eyes? See, this is again a very good question, because at this time, many are trying to have this online education for children. So then definitely the screen time for which a child is exposed is obviously going to increase. But for a young, for younger children, I think it's fine for 2-3 hours. It should be okay. And for older children, try to have alternate, like, you know, probably contact classes for a few subjects, and then, you know, online classes for few subjects, depending on which subject needs to be taught more personally. And in this way, the screen time use can be limited. And you can even educate the parent that since already the child is being exposed to screen time because of online education, try to avoid other screen time at home, where possibly a child would like to watch a movie or, you know, play games. So try to cut down on screen time use for those things. But because you need to adapt to the situations, earlier it was very less screen time which was recommended, but because of the present scenario, you need to cope up with the situations. I think a little more screen time than what it was before is okay. Unless, you know, the distance is maintained, the brightness of the screen is maintained, correct posture of the body is maintained, and the lighting of the room is good, it shouldn't harm much. But yeah, again, like, you know, for anything, just keep giving breaks between, rather than a constant a video session. Always it's better to have a half an hour, 45 minute session, give a break, and then probably again after a couple of hours, another session, or time the days accordingly. There's another question. This is really difficult time. The support we can get from such hospital like you, can we have any association to extend? Yeah, I see. Always, you know, we as healthcare workers or anyone who's in the medical field is always ready to help and come and associate. So yeah, see, everyone is there to help each other in situation, and only if people are connected, then it would be a safer thing for children, for the staff, and for everyone else. Yeah, so we from the hospital are always there to help you all. And in case of any difficulty or any things, you all can always come to us. So there's another question from Melissa. Hi, I'm Melissa. We hold hands and help kids to write since kids are small. So any precautions that can be taken? Well, Melissa, if you really need to do that, like, you know, hold hands and help kids to write, just ensure before you hold the child's hand, you need to wash your hands. The child needs to wash the hands, either sanitization or, you know, hand washing. Try to, both of you definitely need to wear a mask, because you're going to come close to each other. And then you need to do this. But I think other methodologies are there to help kids write. You know, tracing the air tracing and all that. So try to use alternative method of teaching. Try to avoid physical contact with the child as far as possible, because even your health is important. Unnecessary exposure to, you know, with kids is not good, safe for you, because if a teacher is exposed, definitely the other 15 kids are again going to be exposed. So try to avoid any physical close, you know, teaching with the child, unless it's really, really required. And you know, helping the kids to write and teach, I think you can give this assignment to the parent so that at home they'll be able to make them practice that. But I think at school, maintain social distance between the teacher and the students, between the students as well. Everyone's health is equally important. And try to teach at from, you know, you really need to go and sit with the kid if they're having some emotional meltdowns or anything. But, you know, for other teaching aspects, it's always better you maintain the distance. Okay. So we have another question from Hemalata. Pre-primary students often go to the washroom and the sub-staff will be changing diapers of the child thrice a day and will be close contact with the child, though we will be checking the temperature of the person. However, there won't be any symptoms shown in 14 days. Half days will be better for pre-primary students because they can't wear a mask for the long time. They can have lunch at home. Please, when you're starting with, especially for the kindergarten or pre-primary kids, you need to have a drill kind of thing. Initially, you probably need to call the students for one really required. And if the children and if everyone is able to adapt to the situation, then try to, you know, increase the duration. Randomly, if you just call them and you have a complete, you know, 4-hour class or a 6-hour day at school, it's going to be difficult. So if you're really going to have kindergarten or pre-primary children attending school, it's always better to have a drill session for 1 hour, then extend it for 2 hours, and then extend it for 3 hours. And the person who's attending and who's changing the diapers, I think that person should be, you know, wearing an apron, wearing a head, you know, like how I'm doing, wearing a mask, so that, because she's in close association with the children, even, you know, it should, she shouldn't get it and then again spread to other children. So she definitely needs to have a proper PPE. And then strict hand hygiene measures should be followed by her. And you need to sanitize the diaper changing table or the table which you're using to change the diapers each time you get a different child to prevent the spread of the infection. Okay, so there is another question from Srinivas. Could you please advise rainy season instruction right now, whether it's too cold? See, this question, you need to understand now it's going to be monsoon and next winter is going to come up. So the children are definitely going to get exposed to cold weather, which usually they get exposed every year. But the only difference is now because of the coronavirus prevailing, the situation's a little different. But, you know, the general precautions for the child takes. I'm sure every school has issues a leather jacket or a sweater and then ensure that the child is wearing trousers. That should be okay. No specific thing. Just try to avoid cold stuff during this period and avoid getting direct exposure to cold weather when they are traveling either in a bike or a bus. Just ensure that the windows are not open. Okay, so we have another question from Franklin. Follow the proper hand hygiene techniques. Gloves are really not necessary because if a child is wearing gloves and again touching surfaces and again with the gloves touching the face and the nose, it's not going to be effective. So, and I'm sure they wouldn't be comfortable, younger children especially, gloves. So a proper hand hygiene is what is recommended. A regular pair of gloves is really not required if they are following good hand hygiene techniques. But for older children, in case you know they're willing enough, then it should be okay. But a good hand hygiene is equal to a good pair of gloves, unless there's any suspected child with corona, or if any if they're getting exposed to anyone who's having cold cough, or if anyone is touching soil secretions or fluids, like someone has a vomiting and there's or, you know, the whole vomit on the ground, or someone has an accident and it's there, the fluid, body secretions are there, then definitely they need to wear gloves. And the hand, the staff, the housekeeping staff needs to wear gloves whenever they're disinfecting or sanitizing the areas. The staff as well, in case, you know, they need to distribute things to the children and all, they can wear gloves, but a child need not wear gloves. So the next question is from Sunita. If the child gets fever after coming to school, is it safe for other children, even though we isolate the child? Yes, Sunita, that's a good question. Now, it depends again, what is the cause of fever. So unless it is doesn't look like a corona suspect or it's not proven to be COVID, I really do not think the whole, you know, the whole lot of children need to be isolated. So the initial measures, what can be taken if the child who's coming to school got fever is, the children who are sitting just in the vicinity, like, you know, the immediate vicinity, can stay at home for a couple of days till the infected child's report comes. So in case the child's report is negative, everyone can continue school in the usual way. Now, in case it turns out to be positive, then the surrounding, the vicinity children definitely need to be isolated for at least 10 days to 2 weeks. So that's why it's always better to have children in groups so that all children need not be isolated. And each group has a separate teacher so that even if one teacher goes into quarantine, there's another staff to attend the other students. So we have this question. This is from Franklin again. If they have concerns or allergy with sanitizer, please have a written form from all the parents asking regarding any allergies. And for that, children have a separate, you know, hand washing time with soap, because even hand washing is important. If sanitizing is not an option, then you need to wash your hands. Okay, the next question is from Bernardin Glenny. So the question is it safe for a child? Oh, sorry, I missed it. Is it safe for a kindergarten child to carry their sanitizer, and how often should a child use a sanitizer? Well, I think rather than a child getting their own sanitizer, you have someone allocated to distribute help the child use a sanitizer, and have sanitizing stations or hand washing stations at regular intervals in school, because a kindergarten child is not well aware about how careful they need to be with the sanitizer. They can be spillover, they can be accidental ingestions. We've seen children who've accidentally ingested the sanitizer fluid as well. So it's better the school has someone allocated, which helps a child use a sanitizer rather than a child getting their own sanitizing bottle. We have another question. I think we answered this question. Any meditation or the fitness exercises which helps the kids to improve their awesome immunity? Yeah. So yoga, pranayama, and any outdoor exercises, even at school, where the social distancing is maintained, is good, because any physical activity is good to improve the immunity. The next question is from Ms. Vidya. Is it mandatory to check the temperature of every student when they enter the school premises? Yeah, see, it's actually a kind of screening thing. It's not going to confirm, because now we've seen cases, because even in hospital, we check the temperature, but few people are intelligent enough to even take paracetamol, so the temperatures are not to be shown, but at least it's kind of a screening thing. And in case anyone has temperature, you can isolate the person at entry itself rather than allowing the, you know, child or any person come into school and contaminate, and then you find out that the child or the person has fever. So it's just going to be helpful in some way, though it's not foolproof. There's no harm in doing it. So it's better, because we at hospital and any center which have now opened, this is a very simple mandatory thing which needs to be done. There's another question from Srinivas. wearing hand gloves throughout the day or sanitizing, which is better? So hand washing is definitely more better than wearing hand gloves, because even if you wear hand gloves, you need to definitely sanitize the gloves when you touch other surfaces. It's not just wearing hand gloves. So the hand hygiene techniques which are practiced without the gloves has to be followed even when you wear gloves. The only difference is you might not wash your hand, you can just use a sanitizer, but the frequency of maintaining hand hygiene is the same. And again, you know, things like allergy, suffocation is more common when you're wearing gloves. So it's always better hand washing, unless, like I told you, it's a housekeeping staff where she's directly disinfecting the areas, or any person is directly exposed to any liquid contamination from a child, then use a staff. Or in case someone has fever, cold, and a person attending that child, they can wear gloves. Let me see.
Any suggestions with regard to the diet to be followed?
This question is from Anita. So this, like, any suggestions with regarding to the diet to be followed with respect to pH levels of the body? And immune system. It's been advocated that citrus fruits definitely improve the immunity during this period. Coronavirus is new and everyone is still learning about it, but what at least has been shown to be of little, you know, useful benefit is citrus fruits, and any, you know, just have a well-balanced healthy diet with enough vitamins and minerals, which will boost up the immune system. In case a child is not a very good eater or is not having the required amount of fruits and vegetables, you can just supplement the child with a multivitamin.
The students who have the school cafeteria, how should school meal should be distributed?
Yeah, this question is from Rajita. I think this is a very practical question again, as to, you know, for students who opt for school cafeteria, how should school meals be distributed? So I think I discussed this during the initial talk of mine, stating that again, you know, the lunch breaks or any snack breaks should be staggered, like, you know, very few students need to be allowed in the area. Then you need to have specific seated arrangement, because generally lunch people, the children tend to sit with their friends and all, but then, like, how strict you are in the class with their seating arrangement of 2 meter difference and designated seats, you need to have that at the lunch table also. And then the third thing is you need to disinfect the area, the tables completely when another set of students come to have their lunch. Try to minimize excessive sharing of the food items. You can possibly have one person who would serve the food at a place, rather than, you know, just distributing things from one hand to the other. And the other thing is the workers or the people who are cooking food or are involved in the meals, you know, procuring of raw vegetables or cooking them and washing dishes. All of them also need to take all precautions, such as washing their hands and sanitizing the dishes properly, because again, the dishes, the plates are going to be shared by students. So proper washing of all those things also have to be followed.
Next question, what is this plate?
There's a question.
Since several books.
Yeah, how about the school library? Since several Balasubramaniam Rajitamas.
Yes.
Yeah. School libraries, since several books exchange hands, should be library be closed for a particular period? Yes, I think it's better. Although the virus doesn't stay for long on the books, but, you know, anything going home, like I told you, try to minimize the stuff which the child has to carry home, and minimize stuff which the child has to get from home, because surfaces, objects are all source of contamination. So try to minimize things to be transmitted from home to school and school to home. There's another question from Srinivas. Is there any recommendations or proper guidelines to school as well as parents and authorities? Yes, definitely. The UNICEF and the WHO has issued a few letters as to how a school should go about during this pandemic. I'll just request one of the staff members to mail them. so that it would be easier and you all can follow those precautions. Yeah, I hope I didn't miss any. Yeah, there's another question from Rams. Writing notes and correction is recommended for kids and teacher. Yeah, so writing notes is okay because a child is just writing down the notes which is there on the page. Correction, yeah, like I told you, just emphasize on whatever you write on the board. Any close interaction with the child, do not do it unless it's really necessary. Do, you know, keep in, that's why a constant circle between the parents and the teacher has to be maintained so that you can, you know, mail whatever you have taught in class and the parents can sit with the child and correct. Yeah, for definite subjects, you need to do that, like for maths or other problem related things, but definitely have a communication with the parent and try to mail stuff and information to the parents.
Yeah. The answers.
Yeah, I think I answered most of the questions. I hope all of you will be safe and you all will be well prepared when the school has to start. Meanwhile, if you all have any doubt or query on how to manage during this pandemic, you all can always get back to one of us. We are there to help you. Take care and stay safe. Thank you.